for the first time, prospective neuroimaging in neuromyelitis optica. And we looked at the optic nerves, the brain stem, and the cervical and thoracic spinal cord in all study participants at baseline, at the time of clinical attack, and then at other fixed intervals over the course of the trial. So out of the various clinical trials that was done, that were done in neuromyelitis optica, this was the only study that incorporated diagnostic imaging. And so it represents a unique data set, and that is the first data set in NMO with a comprehensive neuroaxis imaging that's prospectively gathered. And what was quite striking was, of course, the correlation first between clinical attacks and radiographic lesion formation. And these were strongly correlated, just as one would expect. So if you had a clinical attack of myelitis, you were very likely to have a new lesion in the spinal cord. And the same applied to the optic nerves and other areas of the central nervous system axis. So that wasn't surprising and makes a lot of sense. But what was surprising was that attacks were not only limited to the area of clinical event. So if you had an attack of myelitis, often there was also radiographic evidence with contrast-enhancing lesion found in the optic nerves. And the opposite was also true, where attacks associated with optic neuritis were also often associated with subclinical attacks of myelitis, as evidenced by GAD enhancement of the spinal cord. So these GAD enhancing events, I think, are very interesting and bespeak to a process that is not as clearly targeted and directed as we once thought. When an attack occurs in NMO, it often involves both optic nerves and spinal cord. And where one manifests the clinical symptoms may be related to other aspects of the pathogenic process besides opening of the blood-brain barrier. This suggests really a two-step process in NMO where a clinical attack is preceded by opening of the blood-brain barrier, perhaps by Th17-positive T cells, which are known to have that ability. And then a subsequent antibody and complement deposition at a particular site within the central nervous system that results in astrocytopathy and subsequent further injury, which triggers a pro-inflammatory cascade that is interleukin-6 mediated, resulting in further tissue injury. So we think that we're seeing something really very novel for the first time, that there is, in fact, subclinical disease activity in NMO. And when we actually think about this a little bit further, it stands to reason that this process has been going on actually for quite some time. Earlier studies looking at brain MRIs did in fact identify asymptomatic lesions present in many NMO patients. This has been well documented. And so we do know that subclinical NMO can occur. What was not obvious was that subclinical NMO can involve the optic nerves and spinal cord. And that was a big surprise. So I think we have a lot to learn based on that observation. We also did extensive studies looking at disability in NMO. And those studies showed, they've now been published, that there is a pronounced therapeutic effect of inebilizumab on disability outcomes in NMO. And I think this is very important because at the end of the day, not only do you care about whether a patient has had a clinical attack, but you also want to know whether disability is affected in NMO. And we did look at disability both that was attack-related as well as disability that may be independent of clinical attacks. And to, I think, many people's surprise, we found that there was, in fact, evidence of disability worsening in NMO patients independent of adjudicated attacks. I think this type of work needs to be understood further. Fortunately, we have a very rich data set to look at. And in addition to the radiographic information, we also have biomarker information. Some of this work has been published and other aspects of it have been presented. But we do have information on serum neurofilament light, as well as serum GFAP, And when you take all of this information together, it does allow us to perhaps understand the pathogenic process in NMO in a unique way. No other trial has this type of data. No other study to date has gathered this kind of information prospectively in NMO. And I think that as we drill further down into the data, we'll have further insights into mechanisms of disease pathogenesis, what might underlie disability worsening in NMO, which of course clearly is predominantly attack related. But going beyond that, I think the biomarkers and imaging can tell us additional information about clinical worsening in patients, even if they have not had an overt, obvious attack. So some of this may be subclinical attacks, if you will, that can be associated with worsening down the road. And some of it, of course, could be as an element of progression in NMO that has not been well recognized yet. In MS, of course, this is well recognized and understood as a predominant mechanism. In NMO, it appears to be quite rare. There are relatively few cases of secondary progressive neuromyelitis optica, but there still may be silent progression occurring in NMO with worsening in terms of disability. And I wouldn't be surprised if that process ultimately was shown to be associated with ongoing tissue injury as measured by either radiographic disease occurrence or elevation in these biomarkers of tissue injury.